Hi everyone, I'm in Dubai right now, not in India, and hence this is going to be sort of a filler video. We're not doing real contributions today or actual coding, but hopefully you get some value from knowing what are the tech stacks that I know today. What are the things that I've learned over the past 5 years, maybe even more, like 7-8 years now? What are the things that I am personally bullish on and learning for the next 5 years, believe it or not? Just like you guys, I also have a bunch of challenges and things I need to learn or feel that will make me future ready or take me to my next job offer. What is this video on? This video is on how you can crack the first, what I feel this channel has become is like the first 100K offer, which is not standard FANG or standard 12, 15, 30 LPA, because that's not something I've done for a while, but not like the whole 4CR jargon that I've been talking about. Somewhere in the middle, like a humble 100K offer, even like 70K, 80K US dollars, which is like less than 1CR, more than 50 lakhs, somewhere in that range. What are the technologies that I feel are good enough for you to know, or like if you know them very well, this is like a humble range that you can target from India remotely. Now, there are companies in India that you can target as well, but the path is slightly different. My path, the path that I took, and the path that I sort of preach on this channel is remote work or open source or targeting good companies / startups that make you technically strong. But of course, you can't join these startups unless you know some skills on your own. So in this video, we're discussing what are the skills that I know, which are basically an exhaustive list of things that I know. And hence, if you zoom out a little and you're able to basically capture these, I mean, I know these very well. If you know these at a mediocre level and are able to solve like interview problems in them, then you should be able to crack a decent 70K to 100K offer in a startup in the US. These are the technologies that are very common. These are the technologies that a lot of companies in the US hire for. So what are these technologies? How did I learn them? And also in the end, like a bonus segment where what are the things I am learning today to make myself future ready, future proof? What are the things that I sort of struggle with today? And what is my path and journey when I try to learn these new technologies? What path do I follow so that the things that are difficult to me right now at this stage, I'm able to grasp them and also consistently grasp them so that in 6 months or a year, I'm pretty much good at them. Cool. This will be the video. This is a filler video, as I said, so not a lot of coding in this one, but hopefully the content will help you figure out and also make you a little more confident in your skills. Like, there's not a lot of things that I know, but I just know whatever I know it well. And also I've also been lucky to target the right set of opportunities. So hopefully you do that with this video as well. With all of that context, let's get right into the video. The first thing, most important thing you need to know if you want to work even at a FANG or remotely is version control systems. Version control systems may basically, the first thing you need to know is Git and GitHub. Maybe GitLab or the third one, Bitbucket. They're very similar. The CI/CD pipelines in all three of these might be different, but general version control, what you might need to push to a basic project is the same. The first important thing to get comfortable with is Git and GitHub. What do I mean by comfortable with? I mean, you should be able to understand Git commits, like fairly obvious, Git pushes, what are remotes, how you push to remotes, how you can change remote from GitHub to GitLab to Bitbucket, and more importantly, rebase and merge. Like, know the difference between rebase and merge. That is enough for you to crack all interview questions and practically, frankly, what you'll need on a day-to-day basis. If you need something more than this, you can always Google it and figure your way around it. That, let's move to the second point. So I just signed a waiver, like a very complicated form, to be able to open this balcony. This is what it looks like. Welcome to the cheap part of Dubai. Because I was staying in the more expensive part for 2 days, made sense for me to save some money. With that, let's get to the second point, which is probably a very important skill that's served me well over the years. Bola nahi jata. Something I found very randomly, which was JavaScript. So in my second year, I was given an assignment by a senior to create a chess multiplayer game, and the very common stack back then, like React, did not exist back then, and hence I had to basically build everything from scratch in vanilla JavaScript, the front end at least, and on the back end also it made sense for me to use JavaScript because I did not want to learn a new language. But over time I realized this is like Python and JavaScript are two very simple languages to understand if you're a beginner, because I mean, to cut things short, they don't throw a lot of compilation errors at you. The reason for that is these are interpreted languages and they don't do a lot of checks at compile time. In fact, there is no compile time, they go line by line. The good thing here there is you get a lot of instant feedback. You instantly are able to see your things work. You don't see a lot of compilation errors. The downside is, well, in the long term, you don't want to use them because, well, you don't want your code to go bad in production, in real time, during runtime. And hence, in the long term, these might not be best technologies, which is why TypeScript was sort of introduced to catch a lot of these errors at compile time. But JavaScript generally is a great skill to start things off with. If you're a beginner, you don't know any language to pick yet, you could pick Java or C++ because, well, DSA is usually solved in these languages. And whenever you're interviewing for a company, you'll probably be solving DSA problems in either C++ or Java. That's what I did as well. I never really solved data structures and algorithmic problems in JavaScript. But when you're building front ends and back ends, you're doing basic web development or maybe something more than that, then JavaScript is a better language. You don't really want to be writing HTTP servers in C++ because not the most beginner friendly language when you're going deep into it. It's good for DSA, gives you nice types and catches a lot of compilation errors, but you're restricted in that bubble of few data structures that you need when you're solving a lead code problem. But when you're creating HTTP servers or doing more real world applications, C++ is great, but not great for beginners. So the best language I would suggest would be JavaScript. Even Python is pretty good. So choose one of these two. But more importantly, the third skill that I learned, frankly, very recently, not very recently, but like 2 years ago-ish, which was TypeScript. I was scared of it initially. In fact, once you get too comfortable with JavaScript, you don't feel like switching to TypeScript because, well, it throws a lot of errors at you at compilation. But frankly, in the industry, this is what is used. No one really uses JavaScript for very obvious reasons. It's not the language that you want your production code to be running in. TypeScript is something you'll have to switch to sooner than later, especially if you want to like work remotely or work at a company, because most companies will not be using JavaScript. It's not a very scalable language. And by scalable, I mean, if too many developers are working on it, it does not catch a lot of errors for you, which is very bad. Like 5 people are working on something, you change one line and you could break a lot of things without your workflow breaking. If this is too much jargon, feel free to ignore. But TypeScript will catch a lot of errors for you when you've, for example, changed one line which touches 20 lines, which now break. JavaScript will not do that. JavaScript will do that at runtime, and usually runtime things are not checked in GitHub tests. Long story short, you will have to move to TypeScript at some point, and something I'm very comfortable with now and have inculcated in the past 2 years. I can't really create JavaScript projects anymore and would strongly suggest not to. In fact, for assignment 1 and assignment 2, I had to break my rule of creating JavaScript files because I did not want to complicate things. But even our full stack assignments that we're doing, at some point at assignment 5 or 6, we will move to TypeScript because JavaScript basically will not cover you. If you actually want to start getting paid, and like paid at this level, $70,000 to $100,000, no one is going to pay you for JavaScript. You have to understand TypeScript, which frankly isn't too difficult if you already know JS. Cool. With that, let's move to the fourth point. This is important, probably enough. You can like cut a line after this fourth point. These are good enough skills for you to get that first 70K offer. In fact, my first 70K to 100K offer, I knew only point 1, 2, 3, and the fourth one, which I'm going to talk about now, which is the Mern stack. For me, even Python has a similar stack called the Django stack, which works as well. But specifically for me, it was the Mern stack. What is the Mern stack? It stands for MongoDB as the backend, which really isn't true. Like no one uses Mongo, frankly. People use SQL. E stands for Express, which is the HTTP server we used in our assignment as well. R stands for React, and N stands for Node.js. So it's basically an acronym for a stack that's commonly used. Now you might switch things here and there. You might switch from React to Angular, hopefully not, but that also happens in some companies. You might definitely switch from MongoDB to like an SQL database, but that's pretty much it. So front end usually in React, back end in Node.js, all of this in TypeScript, not JavaScript, and Express as the HTTP server is a very popular framework, very scalable framework that a lot of startups companies use. It's not the fastest framework out there. If you write an HTTP server in C++ or Rust, it's actually much faster, but it's the one you can find developer talent for very easily, which is why a lot of portions of code bases of companies are in this stack, because it's easy and cheaper to hire developers for the Mern stack than, let's say, for a C++ HTTP server, like someone who knows C++ very well. Even though those might be fast, you don't need that kind of speed in most parts of your code base, and hence most companies will stick to the Mern stack for their decent chunk of code base, and hence they need Mern stack developers. That's all I knew for my first remote job, second remote job. For that, I learned a few more things which I'll be talking about now. But for my first remote job, which is like a 70k offer, which converted to 100k offer, which I've talked about in this video. I only knew the month stack and I knew a little bit of what I'm going to talk about in part 5, but mostly the month stack was enough for me to get into this company. And this is a good toolbox for you to have if you want to do your own startup as well. If you want to create a company, a website, a product in the future, month stack is enough for you to start building websites and backends. If you need to build apps, then you need some more knowledge, but if you want to build a simple service, website and backend, month stack is good enough. So at this point, take a pause. If you know this, make sure you know this very well. You know the month stack very well and you can solve all interview problems. It's enough for you to start contributing to code bases. Now, code bases might be different. For example, in our last video, we contributed to cal.com, which they do not exactly use Express. They use TRPC, but it's very easy for you to switch from here to there as long as you've practiced a lot and created a lot of applications in the month stack. Cool. Good point to stop, take a breather, and like a very good first checkpoint for you to reach. Version control systems, JavaScript, TypeScript, and then the month stack. Very good full stack toolkit for you to have. With that, let's move to some complicated technologies that I learned over the past 2 years that sort of helped me leverage and go from 100k to like whatever offers I've had. Basically beyond 100k, if you want to go from India, you need slightly something more than the month stack, which I'm going to talk about now. The first technology is WebRTC. I've talked about this in a few podcasts. This was a technology that became very popular during COVID, and COVID is when I became a full stack, full time remote employee. This is not very applicable today because, well, COVID no longer exists, but just to give you a brief about it, WebRTC is a protocol that lets you do video communication. What I mean by that is if you go to Zoom, Google Meet, when you see someone else's video, most probably that video is reaching you. If it's live video, it's reaching you via the WebRTC protocol. So to build scalable systems like these, scalable video systems, in fact, scalable real time video systems, you need to understand this protocol called WebRTC. There aren't a lot of jobs in this today. There were a lot of them during the COVID bull run, and hence I sort of suggest these deep tech technologies keep on moving from one to the next, because, well, there are hype cycles that you need to chase. Hype cycles from 2020 to 2022, WebRTC was a hype cycle, and this is one technology I know very well. It's not as much in demand these days, still fairly in demand, but now there are like more technologies that you need to know about. The next one that I'm going to talk about is a Web3 developer. That's the other bull run that came during the 2020-2022 cycle. Over here, you need to know 2 to 3 things. One, you need to know ETH or Ethereum or EVM very well. You need to know how you can write smart contracts. And on a very basic level, you need to understand how transactions work on Ethereum. What exactly is a transaction? What exactly is stored inside a transaction? And what are these smart contracts and what they look like? Everything on ETH is like a transaction. So you should be able to parse most popular transactions, which are things like sending ETH to someone or sending USDT, like a more complicated ERC20 token, or buying NFTs, selling NFTs, and creating like an NFT marketplace. That's, if you can do all of this, you pretty much understand how to write good smart contracts on ETH. Similarly, you can extend this to other blockchains, for example, Solana, where you need to understand a little bit of Rust, and then you can write similar smart contracts. The data model there is very different, so you have to pretty much choose a blockchain and then go very deep in it. I would suggest you go into EVM, because EVM or Ethereum, you can sort of extend to other blockchains that are EVM based, for example, Polygon. So this again was a bull run, right now is a bear run. So choose wisely if you have the choice. We all know what this current cycle is about, which I'm going to talk about in the next few minutes. Before that, let me finish 2 more points that I know very well. One is dockerization and containerization. Generally, deploying your applications to a cloud service, but not in the naked way of SSHing into servers. Better practical ways, either containerizing them or using Kubernetes to deploy your applications to a cluster. Understanding monitoring, what happens when your code base goes down, how do you get called in case your code base goes down, things like these. If you've done this, frankly, this is good enough. But there is another technology called infrastructure as code, which lets you, well, define your infrastructure. What is infrastructure? Infrastructure is like machines, firewalls, things like these. In your code base itself. So on your GitHub, you can push, I need 20 EC2 machines. I need 20 AWS machines running in this specific region. And they need to have this domain name associated to them, so on and so forth. Extremely complicated things. Frankly, if you know all of this, you can become like a very specific niche DevOps engineer, which frankly is a pretty evergreen field, I'd say. Doesn't matter the cycles that come. DevOps has itself differentiated itself as a field and a very hyping field. So dockerization, containerization, Kubernetes, and then Terraform and infrastructure as code are 4 things that are good for you to know and dive very deep into if you want to get into this niche technology. Cool. Let's talk about the things that I am learning in the next few months that I feel are going to become important for me or generally for the world. The first one, I want to understand how you can write HTTP servers or general backend applications in low-level languages like Rust. Rust is the one that I chose. You can choose C as well. Any language that you need to write really low latency systems, which I use for things like trading or like you might have heard of HFT companies. These companies require your backend systems to be really fast. As I said, companies make a certain part of their code base in the Merlin stack, so it's easy to hire developers, but some parts you need to be really fast. And for those parts, you need to write your code in low level languages like C or Rust. So Rust is one I'm personally learning. And what I've seen is ChatGPT has made my life much easier. That's why I've strongly suggested everyone ChatGPT. It sort of clears your fundamentals very well. It's like a personalized teacher because everyone has their own doubts when you're trying to learn a new language. So I feel this is a paradigm shift in how you can learn. And I've seen my speed of learning become exponentially higher now. I've been learning for the past 5 years. Arre, mujhe laga tha recording band ho gayi. And all of these are things I've learned myself only. Only I've seen my learning curve is much steeper now. And I'm able to learn things quickly because, well, ChatGPT is like a personal tutor for you. So it'll like solve a lot of your doubts. Is it a complete replacement for a teacher? Maybe not. Maybe it's like Stack Overflow, it's just a faster Stack Overflow and like a much more convenient Stack Overflow. You can talk to it and like understands your things better than a Google search. Will it replace teachers, courses? I don't know. Long shot there. But definitely more helpful than it used to be in the past. The next thing I'm learning is Python and AI. This is a hobby. I don't plan to become an AI engineer anytime soon, but it's sort of taking over the world. And I'm generally interested in knowing what's happening, especially new breakthrough technologies that are coming out. And AI, the good thing about it is a lot of it is open source. And hence, you can read the code out there. I was recently going through the code of AutoGPT. And frankly, it's like a company I think they've have 100,000 stars on GitHub now. They've raised 10 mil. And frankly, the code base is fairly small. You can understand what they're doing. They've basically built a very nice layer on top of OpenAI and a bunch of other companies that provide GPT APIs. So it's like a good... You can dive into that code base if you understand Python pretty well. So leverage the power of open source. Everything is out there and now you have an AI to help you. These are the technologies I knew. These are the technologies that I'm learning. Tell me what you're learning these days, what you're excited about. I'm still fairly bullish on tech in general, remote software development, or people getting hired based on their skills and not based on where they're located or their accent. So hopefully these technologies, if you inculcate the ones I told initially, think 70k to 100k is a humble number to ask for. If you know AI, Rust, things like these, maybe a little bit more. I don't know. But this is what like I know. It's like none of this is rocket science. It's all available on the internet. As long as you have the will to learn and you practice a lot. For me, that was like working with a bunch of clients and doing the same thing 20 times. Once you do that 20 times, 21st time, it becomes fairly easy. And there are like common pitfalls that come when you're tackling a code base or like similar bugs that you see everywhere. So as long as you practice a lot, you should be able to understand code bases and like become like a good software developer. But like no one will teach you. You don't need a mentor. All you need is practice. So practice a lot. I've given you the technologies that I think are good. If you're already doing something else, great. Keep doing it. If you did not know, hopefully this was a good roadmap. With that, let's end the video. I'll see you guys back in India. I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye.